Hello friends, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Jayadeep Sharangi, Faculty, Department of English, Jogesh Chandra Chaudhary College, University of Calcutta, Kolkata. Friends, we are into module 18. This module titles as The Fairy Queen. In this particular module, this module is prepared by Dr. Kalyani Dixit, who teaches English in a college in Lucknow. Friends, in this module, we are going to assess the contribution of the Fairy Queen as a text. In the previous module, or module 17, we have learned the contribution of Edmund Spenser, and with special reference to the Fairy Queen. But this module is devoted to a particular text, one of the best texts during that time, that is the Fairy Queen. In this particular module, we are going to assess the contribution of the text, different critical items in the text, characters in the text, style, qualities, different properties of the text, and at the end, we are to evaluate and judge the contribution and significance of the Fairy Queen in the context of the Elizabethan poetry. Friends, to start with, let us discuss on the characters. Ed Spenser's The Fairy Queen is fairly a long chain of chivalrous events and characters. Both major and minor characters colored the canvas of this epic poem. These characters are not simply the characters they are allegorically symbolizing, to make abstract for concrete. But they are also to make unbelievable, to make you believe. Friends, let us start with the character called Red Cross Knight. Red Cross Knight is the hero of Book One of Fairy Queen. There is a red sign of cross on his armor and his shields that symbolizes the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. He was a loyal follower of Jesus Christ. He is the personification of virtue of holiness. He is also symbolizing the Reformed English Church. So you can easily understand the implication of this man. Una is the daughter of the knight whose kingdom has been destroyed by the dragon. She goes to Queen Glariana to ask for help in saving her father's country from the dragon. She has been portrayed as a beautiful lady riding on a white ass, who is whiter than snow, but she is withered than the ass, or whiter than the ass. Una is the symbol of truth and maidenly virtue. She has also the qualities of Anglican Church. Therefore, she stands out as a symbol for the Anglican Church. Next comes Prince Arthur. Prince Arthur is madly in love with Fairy Queen and tries to achieve her. He is represented as Knight of Magnificence. He carries a magic shield made by Merlin, a magician. He saves the Red Cross Knight from Orgillo. He is in search of the Fairy Queen. Historically, he represents Lord Leicester. Duisa. Duisa is a witch, the daughter of deceit and shame, who calls herself Fidessa to deceive others. Duisa represents falsehood. After the death of sons Foy, she becomes the mistress of Red Cross Knight. She visits the hill to save Sans Joy's life. In Canto 7 of the book 1, she becomes the mistress of the giant Orgillo and starts living in a majestic style. Sir Gawain. Sir Gawain is the knight of self, control or temperance. He is the hero of book 2. He is the image of Gladiana as in his shield. Good Gawaina is called God's wicked foe. He is attracted by the loveliness of the bower of bliss, but finally he destroys it. Britomart. Britomart is a warrior damsel. She is dressed up in the armor of a knight. She appears in book 3 and represents the virtue of chastity and simplicity. She goes to the fairy land to in search of Artegal, who has dishonored her. She loves Artegal. Artegal or Artegal is the personification or an agent of justice. He falls in love with Britomart. Britomart sees his face in a magic mirror given by her father. Both are united in this book. The fairy queen sends him on a quest to save Irina from Gran Torto. Then Florimel and Calidore. Florimel loves Marinel. She is represented as the most beautiful woman in this book 3. She also represents the fleeting nature of beauty and the reactions of the other knights. Later on, she is captured by Proteus. Calidore. Calidore is a knight of courtesy. He is the hero of book 6. His character is based on idealistic vision. Maurice Evans very rightly says that Calidore story is not designed to reveal Calidore himself so much as the poet's conception of his own craft. And the book 6 is an anatomy of poetry itself. It uses poetic genres as allegories of its strength and weakness. Friends, we are into section B. In section B, we are to discuss certain features of language and style. Number one, in this section, stylistic qualities, musical language and melody, Spenserian stanza, imagery, epic similes, and figures of speech. Remember, the work like Fairy Queen dazzles with all these qualities. First, musical language and melody. The language of Spenser is a thrilling discourse. It's musical all through. He, like a dexterous musician, produces a fine tune, a harmony of sounds, sense by using the most elementary words to perfection. liquid vowels, consonants such as U, O, L, M, N are used in quick succession. And remember, these vowel sounds are responsible for the liquidity of language. He uses onomatopoeic words to create melodic effect. Students of literature must be familiar with onomatopoeia, sound echoing the sense. He also uses medial rhymes and alliteration. Alliteration, particularly assonance, is striking in the case of poetry. A number of stanzas can be quoted for their rhyme, rhythm, alliteration, and soothing, easy-flowing melody. William Hazlitt rightly remarks, "Spenser was the poet of our waking dreams, and he has invented not only a language but music of his own for them." Now, friends, never forget the Spenserian stanza. Spenser invented a stanza format, which is known as Spenserian stanza. This newly invented form of stanza is popularized by himself only. It contains 9 lines. He took its inspiration from the Italian variety of stanza, popularly known as ottava rima, which was used by Ariosto and Tasso. It took its shape by the Italians. Ottava rima. Ottava rima, stanza form, ebi, 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 sissi. Rhyme royal, stanza form, ABA, double B, CC. And the stanza used by Chaucer in the Monk's Tale, ABA, BB, CBC. The first 8 lines of the Spenserian stanza are written in iambic pentameter. Friends, as you all know, iambic meter, accented, first unaccented, followed by accented. So, unaccented, accented pattern. Decasyllabic lines composed in iambic meter. The 9th line remains longer. It contains 12 syllables, as in the case of hexameter. It is also called Alexandrine. The rhyme scheme of Spenserian stanza is AB, ABBC, BCC. 4 lines end with same rhyme, that is B, and 3 other lines end with the same rhyme, C. Friends, after Spenserian stanza form, we should discuss at length about imagery. Spenser employed vivid and sparkling imagery in this book. The most common type of imagery is visual imagery. He paints beautiful pictures with the strokes of his words, phrases, idioms. Spenser's imagery is most of the time concrete. William Hazlitt very rightly remarks, he is the painter of abstractions and describes them with dazzling minuteness, unquote. In the Canto 1 of the book, he gives a graphic description of the forest, where he portrays the picture of various types of trees like cedar, pine, elms, poplars, cypress, and on. Queen Lucifer's place has to be painted graphically. he also presents the vivid picture of Lucifer's chariot. The fight between the Red Cross Knight and Orgoglio, the fight between Prince Arthur and Giant Orgoglio, two very good examples of vivid imagery produced by Spencer. The heart-rending portrayal of the pain and the afflictions of the Red Knight Cross Knight have been pictured dexterously. So, Spencer is a word painter. Imagery. Lovely image of beautiful rosy-fingered Aurora exhibits Spencer's extraordinary, charming portrayal of natural scenarios. He is master in this regard. Graphic description of fight between the Red Cross Knight and Sansfoy is also very interesting. He also presents the seven stars known as boots. In the same stanza, we find visual, auditory, and tactile images simultaneously. In a word, reading his poems is feasting out with images. Now, friends, epic similes. He also makes use of epic similes or Homeric similes in Fairy Queen. In Book 1, Canto 3, he uses Homeric similes drawn from classical mythology. In stanza 20 and 21 of Book 1, Canto 1, the numerous progeny of the monster is compared to 10,000 kinds of creatures that breed in the mud left behind by retreating flood water in the Nile River. Here the monster is indubitably mythical, but the image of River Nile and retreating flood water is very much realistic. So, his dealing with epic similes is realistic as well as imaginary. Now, friends, Fairy Queen is the fairy land for the use of figures of speech. There are multiple figures of speech used by Spencer in this particular text. We may mention a few of them in this particular module. Number one, the use of metaphors, that implied similes in the context of comparison. Homeric similes or epic similes, symbols, which is a stock device, alliteration, excessive use of one consonantal or vowel sound, assonance, consonance, hyperbole, the exaggeration, mythological references or allusions, these are mandatory for any epic poem. Personifications and onomatopoeia. Onomatopoeia scattered here and there in abundance, and use of onomatopoeia add charm to their discourse. Friends, simile. It seems that Spencer's figurative use of speech and a stock device is simile. Let us cite one example. The lady, when she saw her champion fall like the old ruins of a broken tower. 1, 2, 20. That was Book 1, Canto 2, line 20. Her angel's face, as the great eyes of heaven shined bright, and the midday sunshine in the shady place, did never mortal eye behold such heavenly grace. The lion would not leave her desolate, but with her went along as a strong gird of a chaste person, exceeding shone like Phoebus' fairest child, and hip blows like varian hammers cret. Scarce could be footing find in the foul way, for many crosses like great lie stand up murdered men with herein strewed lay without remorse. So, with all these figurative uses and stylistic devices, we can note the mastery of the master writer. Now, to conclude this, the contribution of Spenser is enormous in the history of English literature. Apart from his stylistic innovations, including Spenserian stanza format, use of images, use of similes, use of different musical and lyrical sounds, consonants, different rhetorics, he has made a mastery over the thought process. Therefore, Spenser's The Faerie Queen is one of the biggest and the most precious gems in the treasure box of English literature all time. I hope you enjoyed the module thoroughly. Thank you.
My I sat within a valley green, sat there with my true love. My heart strove to choose between me old love and the new love. Me old for her, the new that made me think on and shook the golden barley. 'Twas hard the mournful words to frame, to break the ties that bound us, but harder still to bear the shame of foreign chains around. Said the mountain glen, I'll seek at morning early and join the brave united man while soft wind shook the barley. 'Twas sad I kissed away her tears, her arms around me when to my ears that fateful shot came out of the wild wood ringing. The bullet pierced my true love's breast in life's young spring so early, and then upon my breast she died while soft wind shook. Thank you. and many is the summer blossom. I pleased with branches soft and green about a gold-stained bosom. I wept and kissed her clay cold corpse, then rushed her veil and valley, my vengeance on the foe to back, while soft wind shook the barley. T'was blood for blood without remorse I took at Woolard Hollow. I placed my two loves clay cold corpse where mine full soon follow. Around a grave I wandered dream, noon night and morn.